Hey guys, Chris here with the Good Old Gamer. So yesterday I did my initial analysis of an AMD's Computex event, and it looks like everything's going really, really well for AMD right now. There's a lot of footage out there. Everybody's got a pretty positive opinion of that keynote speech. Now, unfortunately, NVIDIA's keynote was delayed. I couldn't stay up for that, but apparently not much really happened there. So we didn't really miss anything on that point. So today I've been thinking a lot about what we've been talking about, with a lot of the comments you guys have had on this video. And the one that I really want to address is there's a lot of people that are upset with the price to performance that we're starting to see from AMD. And this is mostly coming from the CPU side because that we got prices on, but a lot of people are very concerned about what Navi's going to bring. And I keep seeing it has to be this much faster at this low of a price, otherwise I'm not going to buy it and nobody should care. So that's what I want to talk to you guys about here today, is the price to performance ratio that we're seeing on the CPU side and how I think that's going to translate into the GPU side of things. So over here on AnandTech, they have a list of all of the new Ryzen 3000 CPUs that have been announced. Now, in yesterday's video, I didn't speak about the Ryzen 5s because they weren't in the main keynote speech, but these were put on AMD's website. You do have the Ryzen 5 3600X and the Ryzen 5 3600. These are coming in at $249 and $199 respectively, and they come with a nice little clock speed bump over their current counterparts, the 2600X, which comes in at 4.2, and then the 3600, which comes in, I think it's 3.9, but it could be 4 gigahertz. Don't quote me on that, I'm just running off my memory, but either way, a little bit higher on the clock speed, plus that nice 15% IPC gain at basically the same prices as the previous generation. And that's something that I touched on in the video yesterday, is essentially we're getting the same prices that we had with the 1000 and 2000 series, main difference being at $499 instead of the 1800X being another 8-core 16-thread CPU, now you're getting a 12-core 24-thread CPU. So there's clearly a major advantage there, but I want to talk about these CPUs because they're roughly in line with the same prices that AMD launched the other CPUs at. Namely, I want to just focus on the 3600X because this is a pretty apples to apples comparison. So if you look at this, it's priced basically the same that the 2700X was at launch. And I know a lot of people out there are comparing current EOL prices to launch prices. You can't do that. See, launch prices are always going to be higher because you can always go down on prices. You can't scale it up later on. If they're like, man, this CPU is too cheap, and then they want to jack it up to $399, that's not going to work. So they have to start higher and they can always go lower. But anyway, we're looking at essentially a 200 megahertz increase on clocks, basically the 2700X boosted up to 4.2 most of the time. So that's a 5% gain there. Plus you add on the 15% IPC gain that they talked about in the conference. So you're looking at 20% more performance for the exact same price. And that's huge. When was the last time Intel gave you a 20% performance increase at the same price? I'm waiting. It's been a long time. So anyway, so you're getting a huge performance increase there. Now, a lot of people were hoping for a 50% performance, price to performance increase, but in reality, you kind of are. This CPU right here should compare very, very close to the i9-9900K. We saw it beating the i9 or the i7-9700K and should compete with the 9900K when the 9900K is not able to turbo up to, you know, all cores up to 5 gigahertz and use 200 watts TDP. Limited to 95 watts TDP, it'll probably perform roughly the same and still draw more power. So if you're talking about similar performance, let's say $500, which we know the 9900K is more than that, but let's just use $500 as a baseline point. All right, and then we divide that by 329. So we're looking at 51.9% higher cost for roughly the same performance. Now, they took the 3800X and compared it directly against the 9900K. And if you're okay with allowing the 9900K to turbo up to the moon, this is going to be more competitive. But still, the price point is still significantly lower than where Intel is at right now. And they made a clear point to point out that this is less than half the cost of Intel. And I think that's where a lot of people are really getting this whole 50%. It's got to be 50% cheaper, 50% more performance for the dollar, because that's what AMD's delivering on their CPUs right now. And I get that. These are amazing deals compared to what Intel has to offer and compared to what AMD currently offers with their 2000 series. So this is a major, major upgrade. But you also have to realize Intel is all the way out in left field. They're not competing. They're not competitive. Until they have a chiplet-based design similar to what AMD has, they're just not going to be anywhere near as competitive with AMD as, let's say, NVIDIA are. Now, a lot of people like to harken back to the ATI Radeon 4870 as like the moment where ATI really kicked the teeth in on NVIDIA, because they did. But if you want to get realistic with this, let's take a look here. The GTX 280 was about 24-25% faster, but it cost about twice as much. So in reality, this was only about 25% better value, because you lost 25% performance, but it cost 50% less. So it was about 25% better. And this is literally the biggest gap that we have ever seen price to performance between ATI, AMD, or NVIDIA. So 25% is really the best case scenario we have ever seen on the GPU side. So when I hear people saying we want 50%, it's just not going to happen. That is horribly unrealistic. As we saw in the demo yesterday, the new Navi core will trade blows with the RTX 2070. Now, they showed it running a little bit better in a very AMD optimized game, but we also have to remember that the architecture has been changed up so much, and we don't know anything about it really, that it's really hard to compare apples to apples. But we do know that this is the performance level that they're targeting, faster than an RTX 2070. The RTX 2070 came out at $499 to $599. So I'm going to call it a $550 card, because that was the price range that it was in. Now, if the new Navi GPU can compete with this at, let's say, $399, I believe that that is the perfect price point. Because if even at $499, going down to $399, that is a 20% price reduction for, let's say, greater than or equal to performance. And that's something that Lisa Su said a lot when talking about CPUs, is greater than or equal to performance. And I think that's the way that they're going to start using their strategy. They want to compete and they want to deliver better value, but they're not going to just give it to you for free anymore. AMD is in a commanding position now that they weren't in a few years ago. The fact that all these new OEMs and AIBs are really getting on board and really like the fact that they can deal with AMD for CPUs, because Intel's nowhere to be seen, they can also buy AMD GPUs, likely at a discount, and just do a bundle savings, get all their parts from one place, and that makes their lives a lot easier. So AMD doesn't need to undercut their competition by 50% or 60% or 100% like everybody out there really wish that they would. They only need to undercut them by a little bit. 20% is a really good number. And like I showed you, that's close to the best value you've ever gotten in the GPU space. Now, for the sake of this argument, we don't know enough about Navi to really say anything definitively, but let's say overall Navi comes in 5% faster than the RTX 2070, okay? And I don't think that this is the fully unlocked Navi 10. I believe that they're still going to have the like special edition version if an RTX 2070 Ti comes out. So more than likely, this is going to be the slightly cut down version, which means that it's going to be cheaper because it's a lower binned model. Anyway, let's say it comes out 5% faster than the RTX 2070 overall across a wide variety of games, okay? It's very possible with the new architecture that could be the case. And let's say they price it at $399. A lot of people out there would say, well, then NVIDIA can just lower their prices. Sure, let's say NVIDIA lowers the price of the 2070 down to $429. NVIDIA will never match the price with their competition. They will always charge a little bit more. Then AMD could lower their prices down to $349, which comes out to being about 20%. Now, a lot of you would be like, well, they can't just drop prices right away. That's not good. Well, why not? This is a competitive market. AMD's not competing with Intel. They're curb stomping Intel. They are competing with NVIDIA. NVIDIA hasn't sat on their laurels. They've had progress throughout the generations. They've actually moved the needle. And Intel didn't. They just sat there for about a decade. Now, I know many of you youngsters out there probably won't remember the Q6600, but when this came out in Q1 2007, this launched at $829, I believe. It was a little over $800. And within a couple of months, this was under $300. That's how much prices can drop in a competitive market. So companies can just continuously drop prices whenever they need to. They're not beholden to you as somebody that spends the $399 on something like a Navi and then goes, oh man, now it's $349 a month later. You know, they got your money. They obviously gave you a product that you wanted at a price point that made sense in the market at the time. And when that price point no longer makes sense, they can just lower the price and continue to compete. And to me, this makes a lot of sense for AMD to do. Just stay 20% below your competition, be greater than or equal to in performance, and this is going to deliver them the value that they need to regain a lot of the market. If you've already forgotten, AMD has tried the ultra budget mode, and that doesn't work. All right, so you have the RX 570s right now. They're selling for $125, $130. They've been selling at this price point for about 6 months now, and they've been giving you free games. Looking at the GTX 1050 Ti's, these are still selling at $169. They're significantly higher. They even cost more than the 1650s, which is crazy when you think about it. But removing the 1650 from the equation, this is how much Nvidia was charging for a card that is slower than AMD's card. Much faster performance, much lower price, and people didn't buy them. Coming on over to the Steam Hardware Survey, we can see the 1050 Ti is the second best-selling GPU on the market, with its worst price-to-performance ratio by a huge margin. Now, yes, there are a few use cases where the 1050 Ti made sense that the RX 570 didn't, but I guarantee you that's not this 10% of the market. It's definitely not 10% of the market. Maybe a few percentage points, but not 10%. So we're sitting essentially at 10%, like I just said. Going down to the RX 570, that's sitting at 0.45% of the market. Now, if the 1050 Ti was, let's say, 8% and this was at 5%, I could say that that would be fair. I would say that that would make sense because of those extra use cases. But that is not the case. So selling things significantly cheaper with much better performance makes no sense. Because to the average consumer, they don't even think that they're comparable. They're not even in the same league anymore. At least some people are starting to wake up. You can see that the market share of the 570 has significantly increased. It's about four times what it was back in December. The RX 580 has also jumped up rather considerably and is now cracking the top, I don't know if that's top 10, but it's getting pretty close. It's the only AMD card to get there. This is an entire AMD generation that's only about 1%. But anyway, so there people are starting to wake up. AMD is being talked about a lot more. So they don't need that. They need to be competitive on price, of course, but they don't need to be super budgety to be effective. They need to get into the OEMs and the AIBs and get those guys using their products. Now, more interesting is when we look at the RTX 2070 right here on the Steam Hardware Survey. This is coming in at 0.85%, which is actually not too far behind the RX 580. And this was considered one of the worst valued RTX cards. And this is the best selling RTX card. And this is the reason why starting Navi off at this performance level makes a lot of sense. This is what people want to buy. And at that $499 to $599 price point, that's what people want to pay for that performance level. It's obvious because that's what people are buying. The second best selling RTX card is the 2080 at 0.6%. That's over 33% behind where the RTX 2070 is. So out of all of the RTX cards, the 2070 is the best selling by far. Even the RTX 2060 hasn't overtaken it. Granted, it hasn't been on the market quite as long, but it's only had a 3 month lead, and this has been out since January. So it's been out long enough that if that's what people were wanting, this number could be a little bit higher. And while we're taking a look at the Steam Hardware Survey, the 2080 Ti is 0.3%. So nobody's buying these. This is not the card that people want. People don't want to spend over $1,000 on a GPU. It's very clear to see by the numbers on the RTX 2070 that that level of performance at that price is what people are comfortable with. And that's the reason why it's the best-selling RTX card at this time. Now, we don't know what the prices of Navi are going to be. We have no clue. They didn't bring that up. But at $399, a lot of you guys are like, oh, that'll never work. That'll never work. It'll absolutely work. All of the numbers and all the data out there show that. It's 20% cheaper than your competition if it delivers similar, if not slightly better, performance. OEMs are really going to gobble that up because it's easier for them to buy an AMD CPU and an AMD GPU. And like I said, AMD can then throw in bundle deals and make it an even better deal for OEMs. And all of the gamers out there that aren't the hardcore enthusiasts that buy pre-built machines will get AMD GPUs. And then that gets them liking AMD products, and then they'll continue to buy them down the road. That's how you gain the quote-unquote mind share, is get the products into people's homes and get people talking about your products, which everybody's talking about AMD products now, and that's why we're seeing the rise of the RX 500 series on the Steam Hardware Survey. They're much better value, price to performance, but they always have been when they were in stock post-mining craze. But now people are talking about that regularly, and now people are starting to buy them. Now, the other argument is, well, even if NVIDIA costs a little bit more, you know, they have RTX, and that feature is so good and great and stuff, and yeah, RTX, and that makes it better. Okay, well, I was thinking about doing this video right here. I was going to do a satire video, actually, because RTX right now is a joke. For gamers, it is not worth it. It's worth zero, literally not worth a single penny of your money. As of recording right now, RTX works on 4 games. That includes the brand new Quake 2 game demo thing that they announced yesterday. So it works on a grand total of 4 games, and it costs you significantly more money. Now, I'm going to compare this to Radeon Chill. Radeon Chill works in pretty much all games and ends up saving you money. Okay, so think of it this way. When you compare one feature to another, one costs more money and only works in 4 games, and one works in pretty much all games and saves you money. Which one is the better value? So I could make the argument that Radeon Chill is a better feature than RTX, and you get that with the AMD cards. So if you really want to say RTX is worth more money, well then Radeon Chill is worth even more money than that. So that nullifies that argument right there. Well, alrighty guys, the takeaway to this video is that AMD is competing extremely well on all fronts. We don't know what the prices of Navi are going to be, but don't get some unrealistic expectation out there. Don't think that you're going to be getting price to performance like you used to. You know, we're not seeing performance advantages like we used to. The RTX 2080 Ti is only about 30% faster than a 1080 Ti. That is not a very large generational leap, so prices actually went up this generation, which is terrible. And unfortunately, that's the world that we live in. If people are spending $499 to $599 for essentially GTX 1080 level performance here today, right now, well, that's what that is worth. Price to performance is only what it's worth, what people are willing to pay for it. And it's very clear to see that that's what people are willing to pay. Now, if you give them that level of performance for 20% less, that's an even better value. And I don't know why people would be upset by that, because it's not what you want. It's not what you expect or what you demand. Well, you don't have to buy it. But when you look at the market, that's what people are going to do. They're going to spend their money. I'm not happy about it personally, because it just means I'm going to keep my stuff for longer because we're not getting as big of advances. But that doesn't mean you should have unrealistic expectations. Companies aren't out to be your best friend and, you know, give you 200% performance gains while saving you 50% on your money. That's just not the way that it works anymore. You have to recognize that they're going to charge whatever it is that people are going to be willing to pay. And as a company for AMD, it's smart for them to charge less. And like I said, 20% less, I think, is the proper mark. And if NVIDIA lowers their prices, just lower your prices in kind. Keep that 20% barrier. And as far as features go, like I said, RTX isn't worth anything. I just proved to you that Radeon Chill is actually more valuable. In the future, ray tracing will be really, really cool 3 to 5 years from now. And it's good on NVIDIA to start that conversation, but it's definitely not worth a premium price here today. And by the time that it actually makes sense to have dedicated ray tracing hardware, there's going to be better GPUs from both companies at that point. So for right now, it is not worth the extra price, in my opinion. Well, alrighty guys, those are just my thoughts. I think that AMD's strategy is pretty good. They're able to beat up on Intel by about 50% price to performance, and they're keeping that going pretty much across the board. And when it comes to NVIDIA, as long as they can have a 20% or better price to performance gap there, I think that that's enough. That's my opinion, and I think it makes the most sense from all of the data that I showed you. Just looking at everything, the prices and the performance that people are looking for, I think they can get away with that, especially if their GPUs, like I said, with the new architecture, are better overall, especially in very geometry-heavy games. That's something I talked about in this video right here. So hopefully that's all resolved and they'll be far more competitive. And really the only benefit to the RTX cards will be the dedicated ray tracing hardware that's on there, which will be beneficial to like content creators and 3D artists. But when it comes to the average gamer, it's pretty much worthless. Like I just showed you, Radeon Chill makes more sense. Well, alrighty guys, let me know what you guys think down in the comment section below. If you like this video, please hit that like button. Please subscribe. Please share with friends. That really does help me out. And that's all I have for today. And I will catch you guys in the next video.